By the early 1950s, Canadian Pacific Electric Line's management were determined to abandon passenger service in spite of any opposition. Scheduled service was reduced from 5 to 4 trains. Schedules were rather frequently altered, and it seemed that the most efficient use of the cars and crews was not always made. This was especially true of service south of Brantford. These tactics ensured an increase in expenses and guaranteed the passenger service would soon be abandoned.
You'll notice all the new ballast and ties in this scene. In 1950, they applied for abandonment of the passenger service and the Transport Board refused them permission. Apparently, they felt that they didn't lose enough money or something. Because between 1950 and 1954, they spent an awful lot of money on the line with new ballast and new ties and upgrading the equipment. And it was generally assumed that they did this in order to increase the expenses to make more of an apparent loss, to make a better case for their application for abandonment. And it worked, because the second time they asked in 1954, it was granted. The Grand River Railway had 6 miles of double track. Most Canadian interurbans didn't have enough business for double track, but the Grand River was double tracked from Galt right to the top of the Preston Hill, except for 2 points, the Preston Trestle, which was single track, and they had a gauntleted section where the two tracks were interlaced under the Canadian Pacific main line at Galt.
Thus ended over a half a century of electric rail service in the Grand River Valley.
This was supposed to have been the last electric operation ever on the Canadian Pacific Electric Lines. It originated as an excursion train from Toronto that was diesel hauled to Galt, and then the electric engines took them over and hauled them up to Preston. Then they ran around the train and hauled it south to Waterford. Then they ran around the train again and hauled it back to Galt. As I say, this was supposed to have been the last operation, but they had a diesel failure the following day on the Monday, so these two engines had to come out again. But that was actually the last, so this train was operating on the second last day of electric operation. Following the end of passenger service, most of the cars were simply burned out behind Preston shops and then cut up for scrap. The two combines, 624 and 626, stayed around 2 or 3 years more. They thought they were going to make combines for mixed trains out of them, but they didn't, and eventually they were chopped up too. The only car left is number 797, one of the wooden Lake Erie Northern combines. It went down to the U.S. and it was shuttled around from 3 different railway museums down there until the OERHA museum at Milton arranged to trade one of our cars for 797. So it came back and it's now at the museum, but it's not operational and it will take many years of restoration before it will be, but at least it does exist and it's the only Lake Erie Northern car that does.
In keeping with historic tradition, the area's transit systems began the 21st century by merging their bus companies to form one unified system, appropriately named Grand River Transit.
London and Port Stanley Railway was opened in 1856 in order to provide the City of London with a direct connection to Lake Erie shipping at Port Stanley. It was built primarily for freight operation, and passenger service was secondary. As soon as it was opened, there became a bad depression. The railway lost a great deal of money in its early years, and as a result, the city found it necessary to lease it in turn to the Grand Trunk and to the Pere Marquette. And it was operated as a branch line in the interest of the leasing company. The second of the leases expired just before the First World War, and under the urging of Sir Adam Beck, who was chairman of Ontario Hydro and former mayor of London, it was decided to electrify the London at Port Stanley using the technology that was being planned for the province-wide system of electric interurban railways that was being planned by Ontario Hydro. The line was 24 miles long, and in form it was a standard railway branch line with a single track and half a dozen passing sidings. It had two very large bridges, one north and one south of St. Thomas, which cost a lot of money to build and a great deal of money to maintain afterwards. Owing to its status as a railway branch line, it had close connections with several steam railways, Canadian Pacific twice, the Michigan Central, the Grand Trunk, and the Pere Marquette and the Wabash. And it interchanged traffic with all of them and handled Michigan Central passengers from St. Thomas to London. The equipment was much more elaborate than you would have expected for a 24-mile branch line because it was the prototype for the cars that were to run from Toronto to London and Toronto to Niagara Falls for the Hydro radials. They were built by the Jewett Car Company in Ohio, and finished off at Preston by the Preston Car and Coach Company. They went into service when the line was electrified in 1915, and 2 years later, they added two more slightly larger cars, also from Jewett. There were also three wooden trailers built from the ground up by the Preston Car and Coach Company at Preston, Ontario. And 2 years later, they added three more trailers, which were bought from the St. Louis Car Company in Missouri. It's interesting about those trailers because they were quite a few years old when they were bought, though they'd never been used. They were ordered by a Midwestern interurban line, which canceled the order after the cars were finished. They sat around for quite a few years at the St. Louis plant before the London Port Stanley bought them. At the same time, they bought the one express car, the only one they ever had, number E1, which came from the same canceled order. The original equipment in 1915 also included three box cab freight locomotives. And by this time, most of the business that they were hauling was coal, which came by train ferry from the south side of the lake. And it actually formed about 5/6 of the total freight business that the railway handled. The locomotives were quite powerful for their day, because they had to handle heavy coal trains up a steep grade out of Port Stanley and still keep out of the way of regular passenger trains running every half hour. They were the only electric freight locomotives that the railway ever had, and they lasted right up until the line was de-electrified, so to speak, in 1965.
The standard livery for the LMPS was emerald green with a black roof.
This train is coming into London. It's about a quarter of a mile away from the end of the line. This is as close to street running as the London and Port Stanley ever got.
The first LNPS car of the day would leave the car house at Phillips Street in Maitland for London Station about a mile and a half away at 4:10 a.m. Standard Time. The railway never ran its schedule on daylight savings time. This scene shows the Halton County Radial Railway Museum's LNPS car number 8 in its original livery approaching London Station. The LNPS property was beside the Canadian National Railway's London Yard.
The London Terminal was a surprisingly modest affair. It was nothing but an open shelter behind the camera here, connected by a tunnel to the waiting room of the Canadian National Station in London. You bought your tickets from the Canadian National Ticket Agent.
Several types of tickets were available. There was a regular first-class return ticket that could be purchased in advance and good for a continuous trip within 1 month, exclusive of the date of issue. a regular first-class one-way ticket, good for use up until 1 year of issue, and an inexpensive one-day return excursion ticket. Number 8 was typical of an LNPS car that had a number 1 end and a number 2 end. The number 1 end had a larger operator's cab because the area behind the motorman was used for baggage. At this end, the crew entered the car by climbing a ladder entering through the sliding doors on either side. The number 2 end had a smaller operator's cab, and passengers would climb steps to enter or exit on either side of the car. It was a common practice to operate the car from the number 1 end. At this point, the car turned south from Bathurst Street to a private right-of-way beside Maitland Street. The line was double-tracked for about a few hundred yards close to the car house, and there was a spare track for yard movements. As the train left the car house area, it crossed the Thames River and picked up speed. Trains, on the average, would reach a speed of about 45 to 50 miles per hour, depending on the car and the motorman. The excursion train has dropped off some photographers for a photo run-by at this stretch of flat terrain between the Thames River and Kettle Creek.
They were having trouble with the overhead this day, so they sent out the line car, which was a trailer. It's being towed by one of the standard steel motors, and it's crossing the big Kettle Creek trestle just north of St. Thomas. The line train was followed by what appears to be a couple of freight cars going down, I suspect, to pick up some fish from Port Stanley. They're being towed behind a regular passenger train here, which is rather surprising, actually.
There were no loops or Ys on the LNPS railway. Single cars would be used on the line in off-peak hours. During peak times, a motor car and a trailer would be used. Power between the two would be supplied by jumper cables. They would conduct power from the motor to the trailer, which had braking controls. This enabled the operator to run the train from the trailer. St. Thomas was an important stop on the line, and it had its own LNPS railway station. The original track configuration was remodeled after electrification to provide direct access to the Michigan Central Steam Railway Station. This resulted in easier movement of both freight and passengers between the two lines. The unconnected LNPS sidings on either side of the Michigan Central Railway tracks were joined to form a passing track, which improved the switching and allowed through LNPS railway charter trains to move quicker through the station area.
This scene, taken at St. Thomas on a rainy day, shows the museum's car number 8 as it operated for a few years with the stained glass upper sash removed and the space covered over with a steel plate. Fortunately, we have been able to remove the plate and restore the stained glass, which greatly improves the look of the car. Some of it we were able to buy from a antique store in St. Thomas, but some of it we had to have made specially. On warm summer weekends, the line did a very heavy passenger business to the park at Port Stanley. And they often operated two-car trains, and at times they operated four-car trains. Even as late as 1952 or 53, they were still doing that, which was very, very unusual in the interurban business. E1, the express motor here, is coupling up to a service car of some sort. I'm afraid I don't know what it was. These photographs are all taken at St. Thomas. Two-car trains on the LNPS could be either two steel motors or a steel motor and a wooden trailer, as you see here. The trailers had coal stoves to heat them instead of electric heaters, as the steel motors had. When the line reached Port Stanley, it did a 90-degree curve to the west and had a separate terminal at the beach with these wide loading platforms. Number 7 is one of the St. Louis trailers.
the LNPS railway was not unlike most North American electric railways of the early part of the 20th century. They wanted to make a profit from their passenger service. Commuter travel was not enough. The proximity to Lake Erie afforded the railway the opportunity to make money by bringing weekend and summer visitors to the beach. The LNPS would advertise reduced day fares for beach-bound riders. The LNPS owned most of the beach, and the traffic from London and points beyond increased the railway's profits, and in bad times, it offset their losses. Excursion tickets were very popular during the summer months, and the Victorian dress codes of the 1900s provide a very respectable scene at the end of the line. Refreshments, souvenirs, and reading material could be bought at the terminal booth. Located adjacent to the water was a bathhouse that rented bathing suits and provided private dressing rooms with free hair dryers. Also available for rent were water sports equipment. In 1917, few people owned bathing suits, so they had to be rented. There was a complete sanitary laundry that sterilized, washed, and dried hundreds of these bathing suits an hour. The rope into the water would allow non-swimmers to go out a safe distance with confidence. The water slide was very popular. During this time, steamer traffic from across the lake brought Americans to the beach. Such was the increase in the summer population of the area that it was necessary to have an emergency hospital at the beach to treat accident victims. Before the City of London took over the Port Stanley Park, the area was in a state of neglect and an eyesore. The commissioners agreed that money was no object in improving the park. In 1916, a boardwalk was built. The grounds were landscaped and a kiddies recreation area, complete with swings, teeter-totters, slides, and sandboxes, were provided for the tiny tots. A baseball playing field was built and leagues were encouraged to play there. Additional playing fields were also installed, so other sporting activities could be held. As word of the Port Stanley Beach and Park spread, more riders boarded the cars for a trip to the beach. Soon the trains were overflowing, and additional cars had to be bought to provide service. The incline railway was purchased by the LNPS in 1917, and fares were slashed, service was improved, and ridership increased. The park was the destination of many company and church picnics as well. At Port Stanley, LNPS services provided diners with meals at the Bridge Street restaurant. The food and decor were similar to the bathhouse cafeteria, with musical entertainment supplied for the evening meals. The serve self wording on the sign would eventually be changed to self-serve. Lake Erie steamers initially provided a cross-lake service for visitors from Cleveland and other U.S. ports. It was hoped that Port Stanley Harbor would be the destination of lake cruise ships.
They tried hard to build up a passenger business from Cleveland across the lake, but unfortunately they were never able to do that, and while they tried two or three times, it never lasted very long and the company simply gave up.
While the passenger steamer business may not have been as successful as the LNPS management had hoped for, the freight business more than made up for it. Coal from across the lake would arrive by ferry on hopper cars to be offloaded at Port Stanley Harbor. The empty cars would be taken back to be refilled. A balance system was devised and built to keep the steamer rails and the slip rails even as the coal hoppers were taken off the boat. As each car was removed, the boat rose higher in the water. The balance allowed the slip rails to be kept even with the steamer rails while the coal cars were being shunted off the ship. Port Stanley Harbor was the home to the largest fishing fleet on Lake Erie. After World War II, with the rise in popularity of the automobile, the LNPS Railway's passenger revenues fell rapidly. During the 50s, railfan excursions became more popular.
They were very careful of their equipment, and even the freight motors were kept shiny, and they washed them quite regularly to make sure that they always glistened in the sun. The line was built with standard catenary overhead suspended from triangular latticework metal poles. They were careful of the overhead because if it got misaligned and it got hooked under the horn of the pantograph, all hell would break loose.
The wire that provided the power was offset from pole to pole so that the wear on the carbon on the pantograph would be evenly distributed and not wear in one spot. The L&PS railway in earlier days served the cattle farmers along the line. There were a number of sidings where cattle cars could be parked for farmers to put their cattle on to go to market. As the years passed, more and more farmers would use trucks to move their cattle to market, and the sidings were eventually abandoned and the tracks torn up. When the McDonald Cartier Freeway was constructed, it passed over the L&PS, and the right-of-way allowed for an extra track.
There are a great many railfan excursions on the London to Port Stanley because they were very, very cooperative with railfans. You could arrange a trip on the line on practically no notice, and their rates were astonishingly low. So you could have a lot of fun if you had 10 or a dozen people. That's all you needed to have a reasonable share of the charter expense. This is the center of operations of the railway. It's Phillip Street Car House, just north of the Thames River in London. These cars were bought in 1941, I think, from the Milwaukee Electric Railway and Transport Company. There were four of them, and they were very unusual in London for two reasons. The main reason, I think, is that they were single-ended, which has a problem because there was no way of turning cars on the London to Port Stanley unless you had one of the steam railways haul it away and turn it somehow. Also, they were 600-volt cars, and so they couldn't be operated as is on the L&PS, which was a 1,200-volt line. What they did with the Milwaukee cars, they converted two of them into trailers by simply taking the 600-volt motors out of them, and two of them were converted into 1,200-volt motors by scrapping the trucks they came with and putting under them 1,200-volt standard trucks, which I believe originated on the Toronto Suburban, which was torn apart in 1935, and the trucks were stored somewhere, and the L&PS got hold of them in 1941 and put them under the Milwaukee cars. They overcame the single end problem by simply coupling the cars back to back, which meant that at any given time half the people on the two-car train were riding backwards. These cars were very, very comfortable, nice smooth riding cars. They were my favorites on the line, actually. These are runpasts. This was a standard thing on fan trips. What happened was they would find some nice scenic place on the line and they'd stop and everybody would pile off the car and arrange themselves along beside the track, and then the cars would back up and come belting by the people as fast as they could to make real nice pictures, and then they'd back up and collect everybody again and go on to the next runpast. It was quite a standard thing and it was lots of fun. A green flag here means section following. What happens here is, for convenience of dispatching, he is being operated as the first section of a regular train, and the green flag indicates to everybody concerned that there is another car running on the same schedule following closely behind. Otherwise, they would have a white flag, which is, means an extra train not listed on the timetable. This was a very warm day, and the overhead was pretty slack as a result. And on the branch line into the Michigan Central Station in St. Thomas, the wire under the horn of the pantograph, which is one of the hazards of pantograph operation. And as soon as it came to the next bracket arm, of course, it tore the pantograph all to bits. The problem there is the pantograph is spring-loaded. It goes up against the wire by spring pressure. So they had to tie the remains down by a rope around a grab iron towards the bottom of the body. And we had to operate all the way up to London that way, knowing that if the rope broke or the grab iron pulled out of the underframe of the car, then the remains of the pantograph were going to spring up and tear down the overhead, and there would be fireworks and the substation would ground and everything would stop for an hour.